All right, welcome to NS Meetup February. Quick show of hands, how many first-time NS Meetupers do we have here? All right, welcome. Welcome, NS newbies. Welcome. If you don't know already, iOS programming, open source, these are some of the topics we speak about every first Wednesday of the month. We have a great speaker for you tonight. My name's Steve DiRico. I'm the organizer. If you have any questions, concerns, please come find me. We have plenty of drinks. There's some snacks and food over there. Please use the recycle. If you're looking for the restrooms, they're just past the elevators down the hall. With those kind of things said, I'd like to introduce tonight's speaker, Greg Hio.
All right, got my notes together here.
Good luck, Greg.
Thank you, sir, in the front row. All right. So I was speaking at a conference last year, and I told a story about I was at my first job, and the folks there were sort of helping me out, saying what kind of things I should learn next. And so they were like, oh, you should, I was doing Unix stuff back then, and it was like, we're using this GUI toolkit, you should know it inside and out. And then other people are like, you know, you should know the command line, or you should know the difference between fork and exec and operating systems and compilers and so on. And then, you know, the really, I work with electrical engineers as well, and so the really weird ones were like, you should understand how transistors work, and P-type versus N-type semiconductors and things like that. So you can kind of go all the way up and down. But the interesting thing about this debate is not necessarily trying to convince anybody, but is to see sort of where people draw the line and why. Like what they think is the absolute lowest thing and why they think things below that are kind of like, you don't need to know that. And why things above the line are things that are interesting that you should know about. So I guess we can draw a similar parallel to Swift and iOS things, where you could be like, I am a master of stack views, but I don't need to know about auto layout. Or people will be like, no, you should know how views work. And it's like, well, you know, views are really just layers, and you should understand how layers work, and on and on and on. So, and again, we can kind of debate where we draw the line and why, and that's maybe the interesting thing for me. So what I want to talk about today is not necessarily transistors and N-type versus P-type semiconductors. We can talk about that afterwards, but I want to talk a little bit about sort of where I am maybe in terms of Swift and iOS, or I guess Swift in particular, and what's sort of one level beneath, and sort of as a learning exercise, expand my horizons, that kind of thing. So that's what I want to talk about today. So I'll quote Jesse Squires, who once quoted me, saying, let's go one more level down. And that's the idea of what I want to do today. So let's see what we're going to talk about. So we've got three things I want to talk about. We've got Swift, the language itself, runtime instances, I couldn't think of a better word, but it will be clear what I mean by that, and the standard library. So those are the three sort of big components I think that we deal with all the time. Again, the language itself, our app running at runtime, and we all deal with the Swift standard library. So the three things underneath I want to talk about are SIL, that's the Swift intermediate language, we'll look at reflection, and debug tool chains. Again, not the best word. I was trying to find something short that fit in the box, so that's what I came up with. This is my usual disclaimer slide where I try to make things practical. Some of the things are just nice for trivia. Some of the things are interesting. Maybe some of the things are things that you already know. But again, this is sort of my talk about where am I and what is the thing that's one level below that I'm interested in learning about. So hopefully there'll be something interesting and something useful for you, depending on where you are in terms of your Swift compiler lives. So we'll start with Swift. This diagram is necessary whenever you talk about Swift. I'm sure you've seen it a number of times. I think a lot of times we think of the compiler as like a black box where you put your code in at the top and then stuff happens and you get a binary or your app at the other end. But for Swift, it's actually pretty complex. There's a lot of steps in between. So the one that's the AST is the abstract syntax tree, so it does like parsing, and then it does semantic analysis, and it puts types on there. But then the sort of next language-y down is SIL, that's the Swift Intermediate Language. And so just like the internet, you can think of a compiler as like a series of tubes, where your code goes in, and then stuff happens, there's like fermentation processes, is it hot, is it cold, and at the other end comes something. And maybe the question that we have is, how long is the tube, how long, what's going on in each stage, in each of those different steps, and so on. So we'll go all the way back to the old days and say, back in the day, you could just get like numbers and poke them into memory and execute them. So this is like, add two 8-bit integers, that's 0, and then 8e is like, move a value from this register to another register. And so you could just put those values directly into memory and run it. Or maybe you could get like toggle switches and write it in binary on the front of a computer physically and then put it in. But that's no way to live, and so people came up with assembly language, and they said, let's make it slightly more comprehensible, but still incomprehensible, and say, and draw this line. Back in the old days, we were like level zero programming. We're like going directly to the machine, and then we'll take a small step up and go to like level one programming, and we'll write this assembly language, and then we'll have an assembler that turns that into binary. And so the world moves on. And then people said, wait a minute, I can like come up with my own language, and I'll write a C compiler, and I'll write a language, and then the compiler will write assembly, and then we already know how to turn assembly into binary, and so on. So people sort of add front ends to this thing. And indeed, Objective-C, which many of us know and love, started out as like a giant set of preprocessor macros, where you would write Objective-C, it would basically run the preprocessor, turn that into normal C, which would then be compiled by a C compiler, which would turn into assembly, and so on and so on. And then eventually Objective-C sort of becomes its own thing and gets its own compiler. So there we are there. And then in the modern day, we had LLVM and Clang, which adds one more step in between. So the C code doesn't go directly to like machine code, but it takes this intermediate step to the IR, that's the intermediate representation. So we've got our line of C. Apologies for the C and the semicolons. And then it turns into intermediate representation. You can see the printf, and you can see down over here, there's still a printf, so you can still kind of read it. That's the intermediate representation. And then that turns into assembly. Apologies for the AT&T syntax. You can again see the printf, so it's still sort of comprehensible. There's some other stuff going on. And then that gets turned into some kind of a binary that then executes. So that's sort of where we are with C, C++, Objective-C. But this step over here, this one over there, is pretty complex. You have a really complicated language like Objective-C with classes and protocols and conformance and all this stuff, and you have to jump right to that IR, which you saw before. It looks kind of like assembly language. That's a really big step. And so the big change with Swift is that they added one more step, and we go from Swift to SIL, and then to intermediate representation, and then, you know, we're so high up now we don't even consider it. It's just dot, dot, dot at this point. And so that's the thing where if you're looking at the Swift language and you want to go sort of one level down, so to speak, that's the thing that we should be looking at. So let's do that, and we will go, as the figure suggests, one level down. So I've got this very simple class. I'm just going to declare a class, NSMeetup. It's going to have a function that's going to do some interesting thing. We'll instantiate an instance of this class, and then we'll call the method. So it's pretty simple stuff. If you run this through the compiler, but you say, don't compile it all the way through, just show me the SIL, this, so it's like, whoa, what is this? Don't even have syntax highlighting. So we've got import statements, so it's like, all right, this is friendly. Swift has import statements, and this has import statements, so we're in a pretty good place there. I scroll down a little bit. there's like a limit on how many lines you can have in Keynote, so that's not even all the lines. You get this B table, or some people might call it a witness table. Maybe it's not exactly the same thing, but it's close enough. So this is like, what are the things that are in your class when it wants to dispatch it? If I instantiate this class and I call a method on it, what are the methods that are available? And you'll see there's my say hello up there, there's the init, and then there's the dinit. So these are the methods available. I think we can scroll back up. And so if you see the comment at the top, this is the say hello function. So the compile or the SIL generator, the kind of code generation there is kind of helpful, puts these nice comments in there for you. So here's our method. There is this function reference, and if you kind of squint a little bit, you'll see print is there. So this is our call to the print function. But it's like, what is this T05 and so on? So you can learn to decode this if you like, or there's a little trick where you can use the Swift demangle command. So you do xc run Swift demangle, you type in the incomprehensible symbol that you want to look up, and it'll tell you, this is the print in the standard library, it takes the variadic argument, and a separator, and a terminator, and their strings, and it returns void. So this is the little handy thing that you can use to demangle the names. Sometimes if you're debugging, I think you run into these kinds of symbols, so you can kind of decode what that means. All right, so we go back to our method here, the say hello method. What else do I have? So the general shape and look of SIL, you can see these numbers running down the side, %8, %9, %9, you know, there's kind of sequential numbers. So Swift is, as Tim was mentioning before, a SSA, or static single assignment, I think is what it stands for. So it basically means, imagine like the whole world is let, and you never have a var. So you assign a variable, then you can use it all the time, but you can never reassign it. So you have to keep incrementing it, and a assigning you things. That's kind of the idea here, which is nice because if you see percent 16 and you're using it, it's easy to find where it's defined. So that's the general look of the language. What else do we have? If you remember the ARC days, you did Objective-C, maybe you did manual memory management, and then we had ARC, and then you were like, I don't have to worry about it, except when I have a block and I have to, you know, watch for a reference cycle or whatever. And if you learned iOS programming or Mac programming in the Swift days, then maybe you haven't even thought about it before. But if you're curious about what's going on with retains and releases, if you remember what those are, you can look at the SIL and you can see that there's retains and releases here. If you're curious about how what's going on with the memory management under the hood. All right, so that's sort of a basic look at it. Why would you ever want to look at the SIL and seemingly torture yourself? So there are a couple of things that you can do, or that at least I like to do, one of my nerdy pursuits. You can notice that I used to have let, and now I changed it to var. And it's like, okay, let means it's a constant, var means that it could be, it's mutable. But what's the difference in SIL? So what I'll do sometimes, you know, when I'm just bored at home, is I'll compile it with the let, and I'll say, okay, great, great, there's the SIL. I'll change it to a var, I'll compile it again, and then I can just diff the two and see what the difference is. You can make really small changes, like changing let to var, adding a weak, adding an at obc, or doing something like that, changing an int to an int 16 or something, and then just looking at a diff between the two, and then see what's going on. So we can have a quick look here. This is the let version. So we're loading our instance of our NSMeetup class, we're finding the method, say hello, that's the percent 10, and then percent 11, we're applying it. It kind of looks like a function call, percent 10, open parens, percent 9, so we're calling the say hello function here. So this is the let version. If you declare with var, then you get a few extra lines. It does begin access, there's a retain, there's an end access, and then there's a release at the end. Why is it different for let versus var? I don't know, to be honest, but this is the kind of path that it can lead you through to say, what's going on? Why is it different for memory management? Why is it, this is a class, it's a reference type. Why does it have to do with extra memory management stuff when it's mutable? So such questions arise. I don't know the answer to it, but this is the kind of thing that can come up. Another time, I was using the thread sanitizer, and I wanted to know how it works. If you use the thread sanitizer, it sort of tells you if you have a data race, and I was wondering, how does it work? You look at the documentation, it says they add code to your app, and then at runtime, they can detect if there's a race condition. I was thinking, how does it work? Where is it injecting the code? In this case, it's not SIL, it's in the IR, one level down, but I did the same thing. I compiled the app, looked at the IR, I compiled the app a second time with the thread sanitizer enabled, and then you can see it adds little things like tsan read. So it's actually flagging every time you access memory, whether you read or you write, and then that's how it can detect a data race. So again, if you're curious about how things like thread sanitizer works, what's going on with memory management, then it's kind of fun, I'll even say, to go one level down and look at what's going on sort of underneath behind the scenes. So let's SIL, your very quick introduction. It's basically your Swift code, but lowered one level, as they say. You can look at, peek at the internals of ARC and memory management and see what's going on there. And then, again, my favorite exercise, change a little bit of code, run the compiler again and see the difference in SIL and see what's going on. All right, check the time. Let's move on to reflection. So that's runtime instances in reflection. So back in Objective-C, we're like in reflection heaven. We're like, what class is this at runtime? NS class from string. We have all these kinds of things. You can like change instance variables that are private. Can change the identity of an object just at runtime even. So there's all kinds of things that we can do in Objective-C. You know, perform selector, conforms to protocol or whatever, lots of things like that. But in Swift, we still have some things, but maybe not as many. But what are some of the things that you would consider reflection capabilities that we have in Swift? Anyone wants to shout something out? Commands or things that you can do?
Let us.
As?
Let us.
Yeah, so you can do as and sort of cast it with like as question mark to do it safely and see if something matches the protocol or the type. Anything else?
Type of,
yeah. So you can say type of given instance and it'll give you what class or sorry, not class, but what type it is. So you can sort of query things like that. So if you think about all the things that we can do with reflection, as I like to do, I'll categorize it into three things. So I like to think of it as queries, saying, does it conform to this protocol? Is it this kind of class? Is it this kind of type? And that kind of thing. So you can ask it questions. Do you conform to this protocol? That kind of thing. Then we have modifications, sort of in the Objective-C style. If I have an instance and it has private instance variables, like I want to go and I want to poke around and change the values. So that's sort of the modification side. And then the final one I'm thinking about is construction. So saying, at runtime, if I got a JSON payload from the internet, random source, giving like the name of the class as a string and the value of the properties, can I instantiate an object and create it and set its properties sort of completely at runtime? So in Objective-C, that's a definite yes. In Swift, maybe it's a bit of a question. All right, so let's look at a quick demo. So I've got this, what do I have? So we'll look at what's available in Swift, and then we'll look at some third-party stuff as well. So let's just make a really simple struct. Let me make some right here. All right, so I'll get a really simple struct. Everyone loves puppies. And it'll have like a name. Let me do let, because I'm a good citizen. Which is string. We'll have like breed, which is a string. And then we'll have like an age, let's say, which is an int. And then if I instantiate one of these, and it's going to be like 4 years old. So that's great. And then in Swift, we have the mirror type, which we can use to sort of reflect on some of the properties and see the values that are available. If you've used playgrounds and you have the code over here, and then you have the sidebar that shows the results, and you're thinking, how does it know the results and what the types and all these things are? So that all comes from mirror. So I'll instantiate one of these. I can say a mirror. Create a mirror, I'm going to reflect on this instance I just created, and then we can just print some stuff out here. I would do this in a playground, but the playgrounds sometimes are a little unstable. So we can ask it for the type, and then you can iterate over the children. What that means, children, is sort of not always clear and can change. Sorry, I need to be on the mirror. All right, so let's loop over it. I'll say child in m.children. If we look at the type of this thing, then you'll see it's a mirror.child. If I click on that, sorry, this is, all right, so if you look at the type, it's a type alias, and it's a tuple with a label and a value, so that looks good. I'll just print it out and we can see what it is, like this. Like that. It's a 12-inch MacBook, so it's gonna take a minute. All right, so it's just a command line app. I'll go ahead and build and run, and we'll see what it has to say for itself. It's running. Look at the debug area. All right, so you can see I printed out the type. It says it's a puppy, and I looped over the children. In this case, it's giving me each of the three properties. As I say, instance variables, three properties. It'll give you the name of the property and the value. So if it's like a tuple, it may not have a name, which is why it's optional, but it has to have a value, and you can see them printed out here. So again, if you think about, again, how playgrounds work, this is basically what they're doing. Is they're using mirrors on your types and getting this kind of data back. But we can't change anything. I want to be able to do like Objective-C style set value for key, but that's not really available unless you conform, or unless you subclass NS object, but for like a native Swift string, it's not really gonna work. So instead, we can, there's a project from Zeewo. I think they did a web Swift on the server thing back in the day. I'm not sure what they're up to these days, but they have a nice wrapper. So what you could do is you could take the address of this type over here, you could like cast it to an unsafe pointer, and you could look at the memory directly and look at, and you could sort of pull these values out of it directly from memory, which is fine, but it's a bit of a pain. So they've written this wrapper around it that you can use instead, which is kind of nice. So let's just give it a try. So for example, I can get the properties out of this thing. So I can do a try properties, and I give it an instance. there we go. Like this. I'll run that after a second, and we can try it. But then I can also, let me make this mutable. Let's say the age should be mutable. Like so. I'll change this to var. And then I can do a set. Like this. Give a key as a string, so I can say set the age for the instance, pass it as a reference, like this. Or pass it as a in-out parameter, I should say. Sorry, I'm writing too much C++. Is this correct? I have to get a label. It's 4. Okay. All right, set that, and then I'll print it out again, and we'll see if it changed or not. So we can access the properties, which we've already seen with the mirror type, but now it also lets me set things. I can also get things, but that's not as exciting. All right, so if I look down here, you can see this is the line for the property. So it's got the key and the value, and the key and the value, and so on. And I changed the age to 10, and you can see when I printed that, the age is indeed set to 10. So you can go ahead and poke around and instruct instances using this thing. It is a little limited. You can't do it for classes, for whatever reason. Maybe for classes, they're expecting you to use NS object subclasses, but a lot of this stuff only works for structs right now. And so the final thing you can do is you can construct an object. So you can try that out too. I can make like a second puppy. But instead of using the usual constructor, I'll use the reflection tool. And I can construct something of type puppy, and I can give it dictionary instead. So it's sort of, you could just put random stuff in here instead, but I'll be a good citizen and do it properly. So I'll have a second dog, breed is like a pug, and then the age will be 1, like this, and I can print it out. And we can try this. So in this case, it's just a dictionary of string to any. So you could put anything in there, and it's not going to check anything. But then you can see at the bottom here, I have indeed made my second puppy here. So we're creating instances sort of using reflection. You might say, well, how do I know behind the scenes this isn't just calling type.init and then passing things in? So you can sort of click into it. You can see what it's doing. And well, there's some complicated stuff, but it is creating a new instance. It's doing a memory allocation for the size of your struct, and then it's filling in the details. It's sort of saying there's two strings. Strings are this big. I'm going to allocate the space for it and do it. So that's sort of the state of reflection. Why would you want to do it? We can maybe get into that next. So that's the basic reflection demo. I should also note I have some notes about and links to these projects that you can get to afterwards. So that's reflection. Objective-C, maybe we're a little spoiled if we're coming from Objective-C and we're expecting all kinds of features, but those features are still available in Swift if you're doing like NS object subclasses, so it's still there under the hood. You can call C from Swift very easily. If you want to do read-only reflection in your code, you can use mirror, the mirror type, which is already available, works for structs as well. You can always do direct pointer access if you're like very brave and don't mind memory bugs. You can, why not, go ahead, dig right into the instances. And maybe there's more advanced stuff coming in the future. There was a talk at Swift Summit last year where Joe Graf from Apple talked about reflection in Swift and what might be coming up in the future. So there might be more stuff coming up. And there's also projects like Zero's Reflection, where it'll let you inspect instances, create new instances, set properties, things like that. So there is some code out there that you can look at to see how this stuff works if you're curious. All right, so let's move on to standard library. So we started with this diagram, and I think the reason I showed the diagram was to sort of discuss what is the code distance or conceptual distance between your input source code and your output binary. And we decided that as time goes on, and that's what computers is, right? It's just adding more levels of abstraction. So we started with just machine code, and then we get compiled code, and so on and so on. And now we're at a world that looks something like this. And so maybe we can ask a similar question about the standard library and say, how close is the language to the standard library? So if you take a language like C, where the language itself is really, really small, and it has integers and characters, basically like 8-bit integers, 16-bit integers, and so on, but it can't actually do anything. If you want to call printf and print to the screen, you need the standard library to do that. And if you contrast it with something like PHP, which everyone loves to make fun of, but I used to be a PHP developer, so it's okay for me. And I think PHP 4 or PHP 5, if you said, how many functions do you have? It was something like 5,000 or something like that. So they were like, we don't need a standard library, we'll just put every function known to humankind into the language itself. And I think they're getting better about it now. If you have PHP 7 on your machine, which I think comes with your Mac as part of the developer tools, it has something like 1,600 functions, so they're getting better. But I would say there's a much more tight coupling, where the language and the standard library-ish thing in PHP is like much, much closer together. So where are we with Swift? Maybe we're sort of a combo. If you have the Swift language and the Swift compiler, that's sort of over here, and then you have the Swift standard library, which is another set of code. So they are like two separate projects, but in the same way, if you want to say like, have a number, like 42 or 10, which is an integer, but an integer is in the standard library, it's not built into the language, so you really need the standard library. And even a tenfold feature like optionals, you think, oh, that's a very Swift thing. But optionals are also defined in the standard library, so there's a much tighter integration between the two, I think, even though they are separate projects. If you think of like syntax, like the question mark and the force unwrap, which everyone loves, those are like syntax features in the language, but they rely on features in the standard library. So I think there's a much tighter coupling between Swift and the its standard library, which maybe makes it all the more reason to sort of understand how it works. Right to the demo. All right, let's have a look. We'll do some command line stuff, just for fun. Why not? Get the right notes here. All right, so let's just make a really simple bit of code here. So sometimes I enjoy poking around the standard library, as I enjoy looking at SIL and doing diffs on IR just for fun, you know, before bed. And sometimes I'm going through the standard library and I'm trying to trace it through. I'm clicking through on GitHub, but it's not always clear what's going on. Like if you search for map or flat map in the standard library, you'll see there's like five different versions of, say, a flat map. And sometimes I want to know. I just have an array, so let's say I have an array of things, stuff. We'll do flat map, so I'll make this an array of optional integers. But one, two, you know, we'll throw some nils in there because we're going to flat map over it like this. And then I want to say, we'll flat map, no, things equals stuff dot flat map. And we'll just filter them out, so I'll just do sort of nothing. And then we'll print it out. So I have some code like this, and I'm looking at the standard library, and I'm thinking, which of these flat maps is it going to be? Is it the one in like sequence? Is it the one in collection? Is this a lazy collection? I'm not really sure which one it is. Which is a problem, because it's open source and you can look at it, but I'm not sure what's going to happen. The text a little bit bigger. All right, so we're not sure what's going to happen. So here's what I would really like for it to do. All right, so I'll compile it. I call it simple. And what I want to do is I want to sort of run it in the debugger and then see which flat map it's going to call. So I'll set a breakpoint on main, and then we'll run it. We'll run it, and we'll say, oh, of course, we're pushing the base pointer onto the stack and move it. And it's like, all right, this is no good. So that's not the way to do it. So of course, I forgot to set the minus G flag to have debug symbols. We'll run it again, like so. I'll create a breakpoint at main, and then I will run it. And I say, great, here's the code. We're familiar with this. So the first line is setting the array. That's great. And now we're on line four, which is doing the flat map. And so I'll say, I'm going to step into this instead. And it just kind of runs right through. And it's like, all right, so that wasn't good enough. I have debug symbols, but I can't step into the standard library. So also, as I like to say, like a cooking show, I'll say, I've already spent 3 hours to compile the Swift tool chain for you. So I've already done the work. So I built a version of, so I checked out the whole Swift, and I built it, not on this computer, because it would have taken a day, but on my other computer. And so you can see it's a release build of the compiler, but the standard library is in debug mode here. So I built it. I can get the Swift compiler out of here. Binary, Swift C, minus G, and I'll compile it again. All right, there we go. Let's run it under the debugger. I'm going to break on main, and then I'll run it. Here we go. First line sets the array. And we're on the next line, I will step into. And now, you'll see, we're in sequence algorithms.swift line 903. So I say, oh, this is the one that it is. Thank you. So if I look at a backtrace, then you can see, yeah, I came from main, and then I came from here, and then now I'm into the standard library. So you can see that this function is just calling the underscore flat map. So it's a little bit of misdirection, so that you make sure you're paying attention. But same thing, I can step into that. And now I'm at sequence algorithms.swift line 913. And now you can see, there's a for loop, which is how you know you've made it, right? You've reached the point. This is where the actual stuff is happening. And then we can keep stepping through and see what's going on here. So that's that, building your own standard library tool chain and then stepping through the debugger, which is kind of nice. But then you're thinking, this is all command line nonsense. I want my Xcode. So you can do a similar thing there. You can still, aside from building the Swift compiler, you can build an entire tool chain. So we can give that a try. So I've got just another command line app here. I'll just go ahead and run this. And here we go. We got our hello world. But if I go to the settings, I go to components, I go to tool chains, I have my built-in Xcode. I have downloaded a couple from swift.org and installed them. But I also have this local Swift development snapshot. So that's the one that I built and installed myself. So I can pick that one. SourceKit will get a little bit angry. Like back in the old days when we didn't have syntax highlighting. And then I can run this and get my debug tool chain. And then, you know, can't do breakpoints in here, unfortunately. That works on the command line so far. I haven't gotten that working. But then maybe you don't like breakpoints, and you're like, I like debugging with print statements, which is what I like to do. So I want to add print statements everywhere, run the app, and then see what's going on there. But again, the standard library is open source. So you can edit the standard library, add print statements wherever you like, rebuild the tool chain, put it into Xcode, and then build it. So let's do that. Again, I've already done this. So let's go ahead and run this and see what happens. So it's using the custom tool chain. It's such a simple app, but again, it's a 12-inch MacBook, so we'll have to make allowances. Oh, I should also point out, you get this little chain icon up there. That means you're using a custom tool chain, just so you don't get confused. And now you can see, aha! Every time you print something, I have this lol hello NS meetup begin and lol hello NS meetup end. So I've gone completely meta, and I added print statements to the print function itself.
Why doesn't it recurse infinitely?
That is an excellent question. Why doesn't it recurse infinitely? So if you look inside the print function, it's actually doing stream output. So I just stream outputted these two lines. Otherwise, it would have been an infinite loop.
That's your underscore print.
I'm sorry?
That's your underscore
print. Underscore print, yeah. No, they don't do that here. It's all right. Let me put the tool chain back here. Code is ready. All right. So that's the standard library. What can you do with it? The standard library is open source, which is great. The standard library is also written in Swift. So if you're like, I always wanted to learn about compilers, but it's so much C++, the Swift standard library is written in Swift. So you can go and see how arrays work, how integers work, how optionals work, and all of that. If you build a debug standard library, then on the command line, maybe it's possible in Xcode, I haven't done it yet, you can at least step in using the debugger and sort of debug the standard library itself, which is kind of cool. And then, of course, you can, aside from just building the Swift compiler, you can also build an entire tool chain, which does take a little bit longer, but, you know, it's just time. That's what we all have. So you can build your own tool chain, install it into Xcode, and then have it running there. And again, because it's open source, that also means that you can modify it, add as many print statements as you want. Probably have to disable the tests because the tests look for a certain output, but you know, as they say, I'll leave that for an exercise to the reader. So that's what we talked about today. We looked at Swift, went one level down to SIL. We looked at runtime instances and looked at what's available in Reflection. We had mirror type. There's third-party stuff out there. And then we looked at the standard library and how you might sort of inspect that a little bit closer with building the standard library in debug mode and also building your own custom tool chain. And so the most important part of any talk that you should always ask the speaker afterwards, of course, is so what? Like, why should I care? How does this make a difference? So for me, at least, like I said, some of it is just poking around and understanding what's one level beneath. To tell the story with picture metaphors, sometimes we build these grand structures, right? We have our applications, we have our command line tools, and we say, this is the structure I built, and it is great. And we kind of admire them and say, all right, I built this thing. But then I do think it's important to take a step back and look at the big picture and say, what are the underpinnings? What are the technical underpinnings of this thing? How is this thing built? And how does it work? And then you might say, well, why do you want to do that? Just for the sake of doing it? Like, what's the point? So I think part of it is just understanding how it works. We depend so much on the compiler, on the standard library. We all use the standard library. We're all using the language. And understanding sort of what's underneath it and what's holding it all up, I think, is important to know. Just for your own curiosity, I think programmers tend to be very curious. You can sort of glean some tips on like performance characteristics. If you're like, how does flat map work? Is it like quadratic? Is it better? What is it doing under the hood? So understanding some things will just, I think, make you a better Swift developer. And then, dare I say it, sometimes it's just fun to just go poke around and see what's going underneath. So that's maybe a big reason for me. Like I mentioned, thank you to Andrew who reminded me. I just published a blog post, and it's got some links to all the projects, and there's a blog post on how to build the tool chain yourself and things like that, so you can go to that website, and it'll be NS Meetup Talk right at the top, and then you can check out the links. And that is three ways of getting under Swift's skin, and that's all I got. Thank you. Steve has disappeared. We can. If there are any questions for the whole group, we can take some questions. Yes.
Okay. I got a comment and then a good question. Comment from back here. Your text colors. If you do black background with white text. that you'd recommend to be associated with? Like, is everything kind of like a one-man band these days when it comes to Swift?
What do you mean Swift? Like the Swift compiler?
Like learning the language, getting your skills. I mean, is there bigger projects that you can associate yourself with? Or do you recommend just going out on your own and finding something that you like?
That's a tough one to answer. I mean, there's always like necessity being the mother of invention. So it's like, I really wish there were a tool that did this or an app that did this. And there's like nothing more motivating than that, I think.
Okay.
If you do like open source and you know want to say, I want to do web development, I'm going to look at Kaltura or Vapor and build my own website using Swift. And you know, there's lots of open source projects out there that you can kind of, like you said, associate with.
Mm-hmm.
That's very interest driven. I don't think there's like, oh, you must join this project to learn it. I don't think there's anything like that. It's more just, pick something based on your interest, just because it's going to hold your attention. So I don't have a specific answer really for that.
Thanks for tuning.
Did you have a question?
I did.
Yeah.
Do you know why SourceKit freaks out when you switch tool chains?
Why SourceKit freaks out when you switch tool chains? There was a whole, when I built the tool chain, it like runs all the tests, which takes many hours, and it also builds for like watchOS and tvOS, so I commented a whole bunch of stuff out of the build script, just because I didn't want to wait an entire, like I added my print statements, and I was like, I want to try this out. I didn't want to
build half the tool chain.
Yeah, so I commented, I thought I left, I took out the playground support, so I think there might be something in there for SourceKit that I commented out. That might explain it. Yeah.
Can you build it on Linux?
Can you build it on Linux? You can build the compiler and the standard library on Linux. The tool chain is, I believe, meant to be plugged into Xcode, so probably you can't build that over there. I don't know, though.
Okay.
All of the LLDB and everything builds on Linux, I've done.
Yeah.
And you can use it on the Mac?
I don't think
you get a Mac build and it works on the Mac. You can build from open source on a Mac. I've done that too.
Right. Can you build a Mac, use a Mac version on Linux?
If you have the cross compiler, I guess it's technically possible. I haven't done it.
Yeah.
Why? My Linux machine is much faster.
They do have cross compilers. I know some people build like their iOS apps on Linux, so it is possible.
So that's
I
just
tried
another level of pain in the ass.
Yeah, you cause yourself a lot of pain cross compiling.
Okay.
Because, like you were saying, that the standard library is written in Swift.
Yeah.
So you build the first bit, and you end up with a compiler that runs on Mac, and then you try and build the standard library, and you can't because your compiler is running on Mac.
Yeah.
And
like the link to the Objective-C
stuff. You can untangle all of that, but it's so much pain. All
right then. Yeah, no problem.
So, guesstimation, how many hours did it take you to play around before this to compile the talk?
How many hours did it take you to compile the talk? I don't know, I did some of the thread sanitizer talk stuff last year, but it's hard to say because it's not like I just sat down and spent 2 hours straight and did it. It's like stuff I've been looking at for the last few months.
2 months?
a number of hours over a number of months. Yeah. Yeah, right.
So, digging into this, what are the biggest lessons you've learned, you feel?
Biggest lessons I've learned.
Like, are you a better Swift developer because of all this?
Probably. I like to think that the standard library was written by Swift experts, because these are the people who have known about Swift and worked on Swift the longest.
Mm-hmm.
So part of me is like, yes, how did they do flat map? How did they do map? What are they using to sort arrays or whatever? So just reading, I just enjoy reading code in general, just to see how people do things. So in that sense, I would say looking at the standard library code is both a nice repository of Swift source code to look at, but it also lets you know sort of how things work, how do arrays work, how does dictionary storage work. So I don't know if that actually makes me a better developer, that's kind of a tough question, but I would say, sure.
Is there a short-term plan or a long-term plan to move the compiler from C++ to Swift itself, so that it's all...
So getting Swift to be self-hosted? Right?
Yeah.
I don't think so, because the whole LLVM, the Clang, all of that stuff is already on C++. There is a... Because LLVM is like modularized, so I think there is a Swift wrapper for the LLVM C library, so you could write a compiler in Swift. But Swift itself, I don't know. I don't even know if that's on the radar.
Well, all the SIL stuff is in C++, and it looks like that was a deliberate decision.
Yeah, I would guess probably not.
Because that relies on LLVM as well,
yeah.
Compiling the SIL.
In theory, it wouldn't have had to, and I was surprised that they chose to write all that stuff in C++, but they have done.
That's a good language.
That is one of the common questions that they have on their common proposals for the Swift language, is when are you going to write the Swift language in Swift?
What's the answer?
The answer is yes, that essentially you'd have to rewrite LLVM in Swift.
Yeah.
And so you'd be duplicating that.
Patch as well.
I was just going to say that. Anyone wants to do the work on Shuttle Tape? Well,
yeah. Besides just curiosity, there is a valid use for that. If you write real-time code in Swift, mm-hmm. you actually have to look at the SIL to find out if there's any memory management occurring which breaks the real-time rules.
Yeah.
Have you checked like a generic types on that? Like a, you know, right now you check like a puppy class.
Yeah.
Or puppy strap.
Yeah.
And I was wondering how what looks like the generic type.
I don't know. I guess if it specializes it, you'll just get a function that looks like any other function. If it doesn't do it, I don't know. I guess you'll get some dynamic dispatch. I'm not really sure. I haven't looked at it though.
Yeah, you end up with a witness table.
Yeah.
Same as classes. It gets quite messy quite quickly.
Going for simple examples, it's complicated enough, so yeah.
Hi, thanks for your talk. So, you talk about reflection in Swift, pure Swift sort of idiom, but would you even recommend using that for building your program?
Yeah.
That,
I guess in Objective-C you could say, like, how many times did you swizzle a method or something like that? And it's like, did you have to do it or was it just fun to do? So, I don't know. I would say probably not. It's more just like, I don't know, just for curiosity's sake. I guess I never really did method swizzling or peeking at private instance variables or anything like that in Objective-C. So I don't think it's like strictly, obviously it's not strictly required because we don't have it and we're writing apps in Swift. So it's not like a requirement. It's more like a, for some people, nice to have. So I don't know. If you're building, again, like Playgrounds uses it. So if you're building developer tools or things like that to like inspect code and help people understand it, I can see the need for it. But personally, I would say I've never really needed to do that, so that'd probably be what I'd say. Yeah, see.
Do you know anything about what you can submit to the App Store? Whether this is something that they would catch if you tried to submit it?
That's a good question. App Store rules. I think Mirror is in the standard library, so I can't imagine that would be like illegal. And if you use the Zeebo Reflection Project, it's just doing pointer arithmetic, so it's not like, oh, you're using a private function on the runtime or something like that. So I think it's okay. Yeah.
But the tool chain?
By their rules, you're supposed to use the Xcode tool chain.
Okay. Yeah. I don't think you can submit an app
if you're really hard for them to tell, like, unless you made major changes.
Yeah.
So I think you probably get away with a lot of stuff.
Maybe my print state would make it through, but yeah, you are. I don't think you can submit an app if you don't use the official.
But your print state wouldn't show up in the App Store because you. Obviously, your end user wouldn't have the modified standard library, so nothing would have changed.
So you can't change plus to minus.
Yeah,
this is a crazy question. So a lot of apps are built, unfortunately, with JavaScript.
Tell us how you really feel about JavaScript.
Do you think that eventually something like a version of JavaScript, maybe TypeScript, could SIL or IL type of language, then you wouldn't know the difference.
I mean, IR, like everything that uses the LLVM toolchain, C, C++, Fortran, whatever they have out there, is already writing to IR. Someone had asked earlier, like, could you write something, was it you? Someone asked, could you write something that compiles to SIL? And I thought, well, that's crazy. What kind of a maniac would do that? Like, Swift, in the name, it's Swift Intermediate Language, so why would you write your own language that writes SIL, which then gets compiled down? So it seems a little strange to me. I can't think of a reason why you'd want to do it, unless there's some feature of SIL that you absolutely love, but I can't think of anything. But again, patches are welcome, so come up with Brendan's script and write us with SIL. Yeah.
Quick question, are there any plans for making Playground runnable on a Mac client?
Playground?
And right now, you can only run on an iPad.
Sorry, you want to run them on the Mac?
Yeah, the Playground?
Yeah.
The Playground? So the only way you get use the print right now is you have to download the app and run on an iPad.
I had heard some rumor that Xcode Playgrounds were going to go away and they were going to put Swift Playgrounds as a Mac app. I don't know. It was just a rumor. I'd heard something like that. As always, I think they don't talk about future plans or future products. I don't know. But I did hear that rumor that Xcode Playgrounds has